Jolly good. Well, I mean, the deal with these events normally is that you come in here and you know in the back of your mind we're going to try and sell you something. But today it would appear to be a technology fundamental thing. You know, we're not trying to flog you anything today, but really we are, because pretty much everything we sell short of a media composer has crypto built into it somehow. If you're delivering DPP masters to a broadcaster, you know, via content agent, via a Spear or Signiant or something like that, it's encrypted. If you're dealing with digital cinema deliverables, again, there's cryptography involved there. If you're dealing with your KVM system and you have to come under the aegises of the MPAA or Marvel or Disney or one of those onerous organisations, then encryption is all part of it. So pretty much everything we sell has encryption rolled up into it, although not that you'd know. So these are some of the things we're going to go through today. And my hope is that if you take away one thing, it's the difference between symmetric and public key crypto. That's the real clinch today. But we're going to talk about some examples of commonly used ciphers, DES, AES, Rijndael, those kind of things, how they apply to some of the more baseband type things in our industry. So HDCP, the content protection system for HDMI, how that works with Blu-ray and all that kind of stuff. And then we'll talk a little bit about PC over IP. And the system we sell, as you probably all know, is Amulet, but how that works, how you can secure your remote desktop so that if you do come under the aegis of the MPAA, you can be certain that they'll let you do their work. So cryptography, bit of introduction. As an aside, this is a little fragment taken from our one-day IP for Broadcast Engineers course, which we're thinking about expanding out into a full-day course for cryptography all by itself. But cryptography, the internet couldn't exist in the way we know it today were it not for crypto. And shopping and banking websites, they have to have secure cryptography to be able to work. Content protection for the kind of material we deal with, HDCP and D-Cinema. Securing files on hard drives. Whole disk encryption is now very much an established technology. And securing remote desktops, as we've already mentioned. And the three technologies that achieve all of this are symmetric cryptography, where you use the same key to encrypt a message as you use to decrypt a message. Asymmetric cryptography, or more often known as public key crypto, where we use separate encrypting and decrypting keys, and that's very significant. We'll get to that in a bit. And hashing functions, where we use a mathematical function to derive some unique feature of a file or of a message block, so that we can be sure that the same thing got where we want it to be, and it hasn't been interfered with or modified. So, encrypting text, this goes back thousands of years, and military commanders have always wanted to be able to send messages to their commanders in the field. We attack at dawn, send reinforcements, that's the plain text. And ideally, you want to turn that into something that's indecipherable, that just looks like nonsense, that an insecure channel, i.e. a runner on a horse, or a radio link or something like that, can send it, safe in the knowledge that if your enemy intercepts it, they won't be able to make sense of what you're sending. And that process of turning plain text into ciphertext requires the use of a key to be able to make that happen. Now, back when I was 10 years old, reading things like Commando Comic and Warlord and 2000 AD, a very popular cover mount free gift was the code wheel. And you can see this one, it's got the eagle in the middle, so you can see what they're kind of pushing for there. But as long ago as the first century BC, Roman generals encrypted their material. And so consequently, a straight substitution cipher, where a letter is substituted for another letter in a predictable fashion, is referred to as a Caesar cipher. And so look at the code wheel here. You can see that if we match the outer letters to the inner letters, we attack at dawn would be rendered as that mess there. And in this case, the key we've used is six, because we've slipped the code wheel six positions round from A matching up with A. We've slipped it round so A and F match up with each other. And that, for probably 1,000 years was the state of the art of cryptography. The ROT13 cipher, which if you ever hang out on any internet forums, is commonly used. Is another very simple substitution cipher. But the inherent problem with the Caesar cipher, with a substitution cipher, is letter frequency analysis. It's easy to attack that cipher because we know from linguists what the distribution of letters are within any language. So within English, here's how the letters are distributed. E is by far the most common letter, followed by T, and you go down through that. And so taking a piece of ciphertext, it's very easy to analyse that for the letter frequency and say, ha-ha, clearly they've used F instead of E, and clearly they've used J instead of T. And we can quite easily, with only a few sentences, work out what they're trying to say. So come the sort of late Middle Ages, kind of 16th, 17th century, French cryptographers had come up with this idea of the Vignier cipher, sometimes referred to as le chiffre indécifrable, literally the undecipherable cipher. And it's an example of what we call a rotating Caesar cipher. So to try and break that connection between the frequency of letters in the ciphertext and the frequency of letters in the plain text, we rotate the key that we use every position in the message. And after six or eight, we go back and start using the first position on our code wheel again. Used very extensively by revolutionary French forces, Napoleon, the American Civil War. You know, the generals typically would use a rotating Caesar cipher. You know, it's just a question of slipping the code wheel or choosing a different substitution cipher every time you move along a letter in the message. Now, Charles Babbage in 1854 cracked the cipher. It dawned on him that, what have I got here? Well, I've got six or eight messages just interleaved with each other. So long as I can de-interleave them, I've just got six or eight regular substitution ciphers that I can attack using letter frequency analysis. And the British government pleaded with Babbage, don't tell anybody you've figured this out. And so for a good 50 years, the French continued to use a rotating Caesar cipher, you know, and all their diplomatic courier traffic, which got intercepted, was easily broken by Whitehall. So let's spin forward, you know, to the start of the 20th century, the 1920s, and the sort of the ultimate example of a rotating Caesar cipher is what we've got before us here, the Enigma machine. Except the rotation period of an Enigma machine is considerably longer than any message you might be able to send. You know, the vulnerability of the Vignier cipher was that six characters or eight characters means that you can still apply letter frequency analysis if you know how to comb out the six sub-messages that are contained. Now, the Enigma machine, I'm gonna spin this little webcam here to look at the thing, and then I can put it up on screen, which will aid the demonstration. So there it is before us there. If you understand how a car odometer works, or you understand how current flows through wires and lights light bulbs, this thing will be of no trouble to you at all. Essentially, we've got what looks like a typewriter keyboard, just 26 letters, and we've got 26 bulbs behind, you know, letter-shaped cutouts. So as we type text on the keyboard, you can see, you know, bulbs light up to show us what our encrypted text would be. And you think to yourself, well, isn't this just a straight substitution cipher? Well, if I keep pressing the A key, you can see that A is not encrypting to the same letter again and again. So clearly this is not just a straight substitution cipher, this is some sort of rotating cipher. And the way it works is that the current from each of the switches that form the typewriter keyboard is sent via these rotors that you can see at the top. And there's three of them on this model. This is a Wehrmacht model that the German Navy used a four-rotor machine. And by the end of the war, they pretty much got up to five-rotor machines. But even so, the current goes from the switch, it passes into the first rotor, and the first rotor applies a substitution cipher. It swaps A for J, for example. And then it goes into the second wheel where J gets swapped to a Z, into the third wheel where Z gets swapped to a P. And then there's a hidden rotor to the right-hand side of the third rotor, which reflects the current back through the system. And we get another set of scramble, scramble, scramble before the current finally comes out again. Then it goes down to this patch panel at the very bottom here, and we can apply an additional set of encipherment, of scrambling to the message. So we've got two fixed Caesar ciphers in the reflector there and in the patch panel at the bottom, but we've more importantly got six, one, two, three, and then back again, one, two, three. We've got six layers of rotating encipherment. And when the third rotor goes all the way around its 26 positions, it goes back to the start and it nudges this one, and then when that's gone 26 positions, it nudges this one. So we've got a continually rotating cipher, which, you know, the young German wireless operator is sitting here looking at the plain text that his commanding officer has given to him. He's typing it in on the keyboard. His colleague who operates the Morse key is looking at the lights and he's writing down what's coming out of the machine. And at the other end, so long as they've set their Enigma up into exactly the same configuration as it was when we started enciphering the message, they do exactly the same thing. They look at the gobbledygook that's come over the wireless, and they type it in on here, and a colleague looks at the lights that light up, and he's got German back again. Amazing. So on this So that picture there this picture here is a four rotor machine. So this would have been a German Navy machine, but the one we have here is a three rotor machine. If you consider, 26 raised to the power 10, which you'd get off this machine, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, patchboard 10. Yeah, we're talking about 141 trillion permutations of the machine before you get round to the start of the cipher again. So Charles Babbage's attack would just not work in this situation. So how does it operate in practice? Well, the Abwehr would print a code book, and every 4 weeks they'd send the code book out to all the army headquarters, all the advanced stations, basically everywhere where there was an Enigma machine and an operator, you get a code book. And that basically tells you what's the setup of the machine. What position do the rotors start at for each message? What do we put on the patch board, on the stecker board, as it's called? And so long as they follow that, you've got a symmetric cipher. One guy encodes, and at the other end of the chain, the other end of a wireless communication channel, another guy decodes, and it all works. One weakness of the encryption, of the Enigma encryption system, is that the letter A, for example, can never encrypt to itself. Because remember, it has to go through the four rotor positions and then has to get reflected back and go back through the same four rotors. And so the current can never kind of clash with itself. So an A can never ever encode to itself, neither in the machine's totality nor in each of the wheel positions. So that's one of the weaknesses of Enigma. It wasn't really appreciated at the time, but it was one of the things that Bletchley Park brought to bear on the cipher. The other weakness is that you've got a bunch of 19-year-old conscripts operating these things who don't really follow procedure. Now, the German cryptographic chiefs in high command realised that there could be a weakness in the cipher by this idea that A can never encrypt to A. And so they would often tell their wireless operators, don't start your messages with the same thing every time. You know, typically a military message might start with a weather report, or it might start with Heil Hitler or something like that. And so the instruction to these 19-year-old conscripts was, don't start it with something predictable. Start it with just a word you've thought up to seed the cipher, if you will. And so knowing this, sort of Bletchley Park, the first sort of words that they try when trying to figure out how to attack the cipher was the 10 most common German girls' names and the 10 most common German curse words. They were kind of recognised as being the kind of things that the wireless operators would seed their cipher with. And so, once you've tried Scheiße and Helga, you're off to a good start. But the problem is that if two different messages have been sent with a common set of text at the start of them, that gives you a further sort of foothold to try and start working on decrypting the machine. So, that's Enigma. We won't sort of talk any more about that, other than to say it's a fantastic example of a symmetric cipher. The same key is used for encryption as decryption. It's a rotating Caesar cipher. And there were many others at the time. The Japanese had a machine called Purple. And in fact, there were other German machines as well. The Lorenz cipher was used by the German higher command and the SS and people considered to be of more importance. It's worth mentioning about the Enigma was that it was not a German military invention. It was available in the 1920s for use by banks and financial institutions. In fact, I looked up yesterday and I found that in the 1930s, there was an Enigma reseller right here in London. So, our colleagues of 75 years ago were probably sitting in a room being told, what a splendid machine this is, you can buy this. And so what we have is a stream cipher because it's done on a letter-by-letter basis, and it's a substitution cipher which is symmetric, same key to encrypt as is used to decrypt. That's the Enigma. So spin forward to modern times, and we still use symmetric ciphers all over the place. Wherever you look, you'll see symmetric ciphers. Rijndael, the AES cipher, is very, very common. Two Fish, Blowfish, RC4, which was Wi-Fi's original web stream cipher, is now considered to be insecure, or rather the way it's implemented in Wi-Fi is considered insecure. And DES, the Defense Encryption Standard, the original DES standard, is now considered insecure because it's only a 64-bit cipher, but Triple DES is still very widely used by the American military and others. But AES Rijndael is the one you'll find most often used online, most often used in the kind of products we sell. It's exactly a 256-bit AES cipher is exactly how the Teradici amulet hotkey system works. And although it's not quite as simple as an XORing operation. It is very, very simple. If you go on the Wikipedia page for the Rijndael cipher, you will be able to understand entirely how Rijndael works. But it's quite nice to think about it as working in the fashion of an XOR comparator. You take the plain text, you XOR it against the key, and then at the other end, you XOR the ciphertext against the key and you get the plain text back again. Very nice kind of model for thinking about it. The nice thing, again, about AES is that it doesn't rely on security by obscurity. You don't have to try and obscure the way the encipherment is done. And that's the same is true of the Enigma. Bletchley Park had Enigma machines, despite what you might have seen in Hollywood movies. The Enigma was a well-understood and well-used encryption machine before the war. And so security by obscurity refers to ciphers where part of the security of the cipher is in obscuring how it works. But the very best ciphers are considered to be the ones where it's entirely understandable how the cipher works, and the security of it is based on you not knowing the secret key. So the problem of symmetric ciphers is that it's dealing with the keys, isn't it? It's key exchange. If I want to send a letter, if I want to send a secret message to somebody, and I work for the army, well, you know, that problem is solved because I have a whole key distribution mechanism of trusted motorcycle couriers taking key books places. But if I want to buy something off Mr. PayPal or off Mr. Amazon, what can we do? We have to assume the worst. We have to assume there's a man in the middle sniffing our network connection and just waiting for that key to go past so he can take a little record of it. And when your ciphertext goes past, he can now decrypt it. And so, well, Mr. Amazon could maybe send you a USB stick with the key on it. I mean, that wouldn't be a very scalable model, would it, if you want to run an e-business. And you have to be able to trust the minimum wage motorbike courier who brought it to you. So symmetric ciphers are not considered a good starting point for network encryption. Now, there's a whole kind of, in crypto research, there's these characters, Alice, Bob, and Eve. Alice and Bobby are the people who want to communicate with each other, and Eve is the eavesdropper, the evil person. They're the actors in typical crypto scenarios. And quite often the analogy uses boxes with padlocks. And so the analogy for a symmetric cipher is that Alice places her message in a box and locks it with a key. You get the principle here. And so long as she can get the key to Bob, or Bob has the same key, he can open it and read the message. Lovely. But how could you do this if you want to send the locked box to somebody with the key? I mean, it's ridiculous. If somebody captures the box, they've got the key. You know, they can open it and have a look. Well, back in the mid-90s, when people were starting to figure out how we're going to do e-business, how we're going to do banking and all that kind of stuff on the internet, there was this whole idea of double encryption, where Alice would put a lock on her box, send it to Bob. He put his lock on the box, send it back. Alice would unlock her key, send it back to Bob. He could unlock it, and hey presto, he can read the message, and no keys have passed between them. That's rather good. But of course, that ignores the fact that Eve might be the wicked man in the middle attack. And so if Eve can interrupt the flow of communication and get the box, she can put her padlock on it, send it back to Alice. Alice takes her padlock off, assuming this is Bob's padlock that's now on there, sends it back to Eve. Eve puts another padlock on. Do you see what I mean? Padlocks and boxes and man in the middle mean that symmetric crypto can never work for securing messages over networks. So we arrive at this idea called asymmetric or public key cryptography. And this is how all your banking and buying things from Amazon and all that kind of stuff happens. And it relies on the one-wayness of a mathematical function. It relies on being able to do something that's easy to go one way, but very difficult to go the other way. This was discovered independently by several people, Whit Diffie and Martin Hellman, as well as the guys at RSA, and I can't remember what the RSA abbreviation is, but it's their surnames, and also an unnamed researcher at GCHQ as well in the 70s. They all kind of independently figured this out. And essentially what they said was, it's trivial to make a large number as the product of two primes. So we take two prime numbers, which are numbers that have only two factors, one and themselves. So you know, 3 and 7, they're prime numbers. But we're talking about very large prime numbers. We're talking about thousands of binary digits. So we make a product of two large prime numbers. To reverse that and factor that very large number back to the two primes is what mathematicians refer to as a non-trivial task, which is a fantastic bit of understatement, because if you're dealing with a 4,000-bit RSA key, which is common, to factorize a 4,000-bit number back to two unique primes is kind of, you know, all the computers in the world for a million years. It's those kind of numbers. It's a huge amount of processing power required and a large amount of time. And, you know, non-trivial. I love that sort of understatement. Or the other method, which is becoming very common, is elliptic curves. Elliptic curves are a mathematical function where a curve exists in both the real and the imaginary space. And if you know the equation that gives rise to the curve, and you know a point on the curve, then essentially figuring out another point is easy. But deriving the vector, if you don't know that point, is hard. And so elliptic curves are becoming a more commonly used asymmetric cipher at the moment. You know, the maths in both of these situations is hard. But what this gives rise to is that we now have an encrypting key and a decrypting key. We don't just have the same key that encrypts and decrypts. We have two different keys, what's often referred to as a public key and a private key. One can encrypt, one can decrypt. Now, this is very slow to compute. It's not easily done in hardware like symmetric ciphers are. Symmetric ciphers are at the level of hardware, can be considered like XOR gates. You can do them very, very quickly, and that's why the stream cipher used to secure your Wi-Fi is a symmetric cipher. But very slow to compute. You know, typically the keys are thousands of binary digits. 4096 is very typical nowadays. But it does mean that we don't have to exchange keys before we can start communicating safely. Now, you think to yourself, well, how on earth do I get the public key of Mr. Amazon? Nobody's ever given me the public key of Mr. Amazon. No, but they gave it to the people who were writing Internet Explorer and Firefox and Chrome or whatever other browser you like to use. And in the certificate store of that browser are all the keys of the big web providers. The private keys are held securely at the web provider's premises, on their servers, in their data centers, and you have the public key. So all of a sudden now, you can encrypt stuff, send it to Mr. Amazon, knowing full well that Mr. Amazon, and only Mr. Amazon, can decrypt it. Nobody else can decrypt it, because nobody else has the private key, hopefully. But it means that we can encrypt something, send it to Mr. Amazon can decrypt it, and now we can have proper secure communication without any worry of a man in the middle sniffing our traffic and saying, ha-ha, I can decrypt this. And so the way this works, because remember, this is very intense computationally, this can't be done in real time for anything other than very small amounts of data. The first thing that you do when you're setting up an asymmetric public key session is that you generate an ephemeral or a one-time use random key. You send that to the person you want to, you encrypt it using the public key of the person you want to talk to. And at the other end, they can decrypt it. And now we've both got the same symmetric key that has never passed insecurely between us. But now we can do high speed, proper symmetric cryptography. So symmetric cryptography is still with us, still very used extensively, but not for that initial setup phase. And so, you know, when you go to HTTPS in your browser and you see the little green padlock close, that's what's happened behind the scenes. You know, that little ephemeral key exchange setup has happened over SSL. Well, now it's called TLS. Transport layer security, part of, you know, a protocol that runs on top of HTTP, and you get the HTTPS URL in your browser. And now, no force on earth, if they don't have the private key, can decrypt the session that was set up when you exchanged that ephemeral key. And Eve, the wicked Eve, the man in the middle who's watching our communications, has no purchase on what we do. The protocols behind public key crypto. SSL, or in fact, is more accurately nowadays referred to as TLS, Transport Layer Security. That's the session protocol for starting a secure session. And as we've said, you know, the web browser you're using, the web server that you're talking to, typically, you know, IIS or Apache or whatever it is at the far end, will offer up a list of ciphers, and it'll say, "I support these ciphers: AES 256, 2FISH, RC4, 3DS, DES." And the browser will say, "Oh, I support these ciphers," and the two will agree on the best possible cipher to be used. You don't want to go too far down the list because, you know, hackers are getting good, and some of these older ciphers from the 90s are starting to show their age. You know, they're not as secure as they were once considered. And so that's the starting point of setting up the TLS, the HTTPS session, and you know, if you're using Internet Explorer 4 or some elderly browser, you know, things will be less secure because you'll have to use an earlier cipher that isn't supported by those earlier web browsers and operating systems. I've dug this out of my instance of Firefox. This is the certificate for Equifax, who are a provider of trust certificates, and that's in my Firefox. You know, I'm going into options and security, and you pop up that box there, and you can go and look at the key. In the case of Equifax, this is only a 1,024-bit key. In fact, that equates to 2,048-bit key because I only get half of it, public-private key. And so in your browser, you'll find maybe 500 certificate providers. Equifax, Google, you know, there's lots of them. RSA, you know, you can probably think of some others. And people will typically go, if you want to run an e-commerce website, people will go and buy a certificate off one of these people, and the private part will be secretly given to them to store on their web server securely, and the public part is available in the certificate store of web browsers. And in the case of Equifax, when Bob's Plumbing Supplies brings up its secure connection, the server will redirect the inquiry back to Equifax, and Equifax will check that is the certificate they issue to Bob's Plumbing Supplies, and you've got a secured connection, an HTTPS connection to Bob's Plumbing Supplies, you know, e-commerce server, but it's been the chain of trust goes back to Equifax's certificate in the certificate store of your browser, so it all works beautifully. We also have to think about hashing functions. As well as symmetric and asymmetric crypto. Symmetric is what the bulk of encryption is done with. Asymmetric is how we set up a secure session. Hashing functions are the way we prove something like a block of data or a file on disk is what it says it is. And there are several commonly used hashing algorithms, MD5, SHA1, which is now considered insecure, and SHA256, sometimes called SHA2, is now the sort of the one everybody likes to use. And part of this whole kind of web of trust of being able to say, yes, Bob's Plumbing Supplies, we know your private key and your web certificate came from Equifax is to do with hashing functions and knowing that a certificate hasn't been interfered with because the hash remains the same. You don't have to make, you know, one bit of a file changed will change the hashing function. Now, crypto attacks and cipher strength, if you read, you know, some of the popular IT press, you know, Wired, The Register, Gizmodo, people like that, you often come across these sort of like shock stories that this cipher or that cipher has been cracked, you know, hackers have broken it open or whatever. Invariably, that's not the case. Invariably, it's down to the fact the crypto is strong, but the implementation is bad. Or the breach is unrealistic. There's a few sort of very typical sort of attacks there that you might have heard of in recent years. Logjam was the famous downgrade attack, where if you can insert yourself as the man in the middle between a web server and a client, so I mean that in itself is not easy. You have to spoof the DNS, you have to route traffic via your server, but if you can insert yourself as a man in the middle in a secure connection, then you create a secure connection between the bad server and the client, and then you can then decrypt and re-encrypt back to the good guy. But a downgrade attack is where the man in the middle is able to basically interrupt the server as it says, okay, here's my cipher suite, here are the things I can support, what can you support? The logjam attack says, it strips out all the really strong ciphers and it says, oh, I can only support 40-bit DES, there you go. And the browser says, well, that's a bit blinking old, but well, we support that as well, let's go with it. And then, you know, you can very easily, well, not very easily, but that's a cipher that is considered insecure and can be broken. Side channel attacks. People talk about those a lot at the moment, where you can, by measuring some aspect of a machine, its power consumption, the sort of the electrical noise coming off the processor, that kind of thing, you can determine something about the cipher from that. You know, the rate of egress of IP packets from the machine. You can figure out something about the cipher from that. And there's been several, you know, university demonstrated side channel attacks on current ciphers. Poor random numbers. You know, if you want to generate an ephemeral symmetric cipher, you rely on good random numbers, non-predictable numbers. That's what a random number is. You can't predict what the next one's going to be. And so the European ATM protocol, EMV, which secures all your, you know, hole-in-the-wall transactions, depends on good quality random numbers because it has to generate a symmetric key on the fly. But the people who write the software for ATMs knew that part of the testing protocol for ATMs was going to be, you know, generate a million keys and make sure none of them matched. And of course, with random numbers, you know, it's quite likely that some of them might match. And so the people who wrote the first generation of software that complied with EMV basically wrote it so that they would pass the test and never generate the same key twice. But in doing so, these are now distinctly non-random numbers. They're entirely predictable because they're being derived from a counter. So a case of unintended consequences. The reuse of temporary keys. So the older WEP protocol that we used to use to secure Wi-Fi, of course we're now all WPA, WPA2, but the older WEP protocol reused a temporary key generated at the start of the session many, many times. And it allowed attackers to gain a foothold because they can look at differential data. They can say, we know these two messages are being encrypted with the same key. One of the things we can do is we can compare the ciphertext and, in some cases, derive what the plain text might be, particularly when you're dealing with IP traffic where headers and the like are very predictable. And it was a way of attacking Wi-Fi. Intentional weakening of ciphers. CSS, which is used to encrypt DVDs. You know, of course, most people say, well, DVDs are encrypted? Who knew? But yeah, back in the 90s, when the DVD standard was being developed, rather than using the 64-bit variant of AES, sorry, of DES, the American government at the time had defined 64-bit DES as being a munition, as being a military product, and therefore was not allowed to be exported. And of course, you know, Sony and all the other people who are developing DVDs said, well, we can't not export DVDs to the rest of the world. And so they degraded the cipher to a 40-bit cipher. And remember, every time you shave a bit off the key length, you half the key space. So a 40-bit cipher is not two-thirds as strong as a 64-bit cipher. It's 2 to the power 24 less strong than a 64-bit cipher. That's a very large number. And so 40-bit DES is crackable now by a modern PC in a second. You know, if you stick a DVD into your machine, you barely even notice the moment the machine takes to break the CSS encryption to rip it onto your hard drive. So that brings us, I suppose, to secure file transport and whole disk encryption. Again, the same principles are, you know, brought to bear. If you think about how you get files securely from your facility to the BBC or whatever, you might use Signiant or Aspira or File Catalyst. And each of these, or even you know, secure FTP, each of these does very much the same thing. They do a key exchange using SSL TLS, as it's more accurately called now, to exchange an AES symmetric key. And then they start encrypting the data in transit. And on a local machine, whole disk encryption is becoming very popular. TrueCrypt, which is the one I loved for several years, oh, it's gone, you know, it's terrible. But it's deprecated, but there's BitLocker on Windows, FileVault on Mac, you know, they all do whole disk encryption, and all the same principles come to bear. You know, the keys are established, and then symmetric crypto encrypts the data on and off the disk. And whereas the Enigma machine, from a symmetric key point of view, is what we call a stream cipher, every letter gets encrypted by itself. Block-level file-based encryption on hard drives is what we call a block-level cipher, where whole blocks, you know, so many bytes, are encrypted in one go. And that means you can bring to bear, you know, more complicated ciphers that are correspondingly harder to crack. And you can also break up any attempt to crack things based on the predictability of the data by using what they call cipher block chaining, where the previous block of data that you wrote onto disk now becomes a seed for the block of data you're about to write onto disk. So this is very, very sort of pertinent to our industry. HDCP is the content protection system used on HDMI for Blu-ray and that kind of thing. And, you know, the way DCinema works is kind of similar. There's a lot of the principles are the same. But, you know, back in the mid-noughties, Mr. Sony and all the other people who were developing Blu-ray you know, flipping out, you know, those naughty hackers cracked CSS encryption on DVD very quickly, almost before it was out the door. We've got to produce something that really, really works. So for Hollywood to let us release high resolution movies on discs that we're going to, you know, sell to the public. And so it's a much more elaborate system, the way HDCP works on Blu-ray. Each player has a device key, a unique device key to that player. In fact, it's not just unique to the player, it's unique to the HDMI port on the player. So your telly at home with three HDMI ports has three device keys. And each disc has a volume key, which is stored in the head of the disc. There's lots of there's lots of crypto data stored at the head of a Blu-ray disc, many megabytes actually. These are then combined to decrypt the data using a symmetric stream cipher, and so lots and lots of keys have to be present on the disc to match up with the keys that are present in all the devices worldwide. Hollywood then has the ability to disable a device because it can revoke the public key associated with that device. And all new releases of discs will no longer play on your beautiful Sony Blu-ray player that you bought a couple of years ago if the MPAA suspects that your device is being used as a pirating machine. You know, if you took your Blu-ray apart, you thought, oh, flipping heck, I could, at that point on the circuit board, the HDMI stream is unencrypted. I could just solder in an extra connector there, and I've got unencrypted HDMI at the back of my machine. Fantastic. But if anybody found out about that, they would revoke Hollywood would revoke your public key, put you in the revocation list on all new discs, and all of a sudden that machine can't play back anything. HDCP, I should say, has this concept of syncs, where the key exchange has to happen. So imagine you're in a retail scenario and you've got, you know, four beautiful big 55-inch tellies up in your shop or whatever, and you've got an HDMI repeater, a distribution amplifier, feeding them. Because we have to have this key exchange between the playback device, Blu-ray player or whatever, set-top box, and the various displays, that has to be handled by that distribution amplifier, because we have to do a key exchange for every single display that's being used to show the content. And if only one of those devices is assumed to be compromised, then the revocation list comes into play, and the Blu-ray player can't display on everything. And so not only do you lose the playback on the compromised device, but because now the sync that reported the compromised device is deemed to be compromised, you'll see nothing on any of your screens. Which kind of, we often get this question, you sold me an AJA or a Blackmagic HDMI to SDI converter, why isn't it HDCP compliant? Why can't I make why can't I capture into my Avid or into my Final Cut workstation, or why can't I make a recording onto SR tape of the output of a Blu-ray player? You know, you've sold me this device, it's not HDCP compliant. Well, actually, it is HDCP compliant. And Mr. Blackmagic and Mr. HDMI, they both know, Mr. AJA, they both know that were they to let you record an unencrypted, high-quality, high-resolution output from their device, and the MPAA got to hear about it, the keys for the device key stored in here would be revoked, and pretty soon these things would be of no use whatsoever. You know, so that's why you can't turn an encrypted DVD into clear SDI using one of these boxes, and you'll never will be able to, as you know, either. So Hollywood has a very long reach, and there have been examples of Hollywood breaking things, you know, as a result. So Cyberlink's Power DVD playback software, the way it worked was it would leave its device key present in memory while it was playing back an HD DVD or a Blu-ray disc. HD DVD, who remembers that format? I actually bought a machine to play back that. It's the Betamax of its time. But if you use the Windows debugger that comes with Visual Basic, Visual Basic IDE, and you freeze the executable in memory and you step through memory, very quickly you can find the 128-bit device key in memory, and all of a sudden it's trivial then to decrypt every Blu-ray disc in your collection and put it up online as a Matroska file, you know, for other people to download. So as soon as that was discovered, the weekend after Pastebin got covered with like the HDCP keys for every movie that had been released to that point, the Hollywood Alliance revoked Power DVD's device key. And so any brand new discs you bought and tried to play back using Power DVD, Cyberlink Power DVD, it couldn't decrypt them, they wouldn't play. And so that seems like a very effective disincentive to people who make playback machines or playback converters or anything like that. You know, if we do this wrong and we allow our technology to be used by a hacker to get to the keys, Hollywood will just revoke our license. And all of a sudden, our software, our set-top box or whatever, is now useless. Nobody's going to buy it. But actually, you know, Hollywood goofed up themselves because later on that same year, September 2010, it was discovered that there was a master volume device key pair that exists on all Blu-ray discs. And that can't be revoked because then nothing would work. And that was very quickly leaked out onto the internet. And now, you know, HDCP is considered to be, you know, kind of interesting, but now has been compromised to the degree that, you know, if you try, you know, there are open source tools for doing all of this stuff. But there's a little clip from
the magic converter,
right? Yeah, well, no, I mean, presumably most manufacturers still want to play the game, you know. But no doubt the one hung low brand ones you can buy on eBay, they don't give a monkeys. They've probably got this burnt into the silicon already. But there's a little grab from the AJA Kona manual. And it says, you know, we just don't support HDCP or don't expect HDCP protected material to work through our converters, you know, and that will always be the case. So that's one area of technology, baseband video, that can be protected with you know, a public key exchange and then a symmetric cipher to protect the data. But also, you know, KVM extenders. And the one we're always banging on about, the one we love, is a Teradici-based system called Amulet Hotkey. And that, to the best of our knowledge, and we've tested most of them, is the only one that actually does this key exchange properly. It's the only one that behaves itself. And so there's a clip from Teradici's support pages, and you can see there are two root certificates stores inside each Teradici device, and they are, it's very clever. If you know how the secure enclave works on an iPhone, or if you know how the trusted platform module works on a modern laptop motherboard, essentially they have silicon where you can submit jobs to it. You can say, decrypt this for me, please. But you can't read out the key that's stored inside it. It's just constructed so the key can't be read out, but you can give it jobs to do. As I say, if you've got a contemporary iPhone or if you've got a computer with a trusted platform module on the motherboard, that's exactly how they work. When a Teradici endpoint, an Amulet Hotkey endpoint, attaches to a host sender, you know, so you can start a desktop session, there's a delay of a couple of seconds. And what's going on there is this whole kind of symmetric, asymmetric public key crypto exchange setting up the symmetric key cipher, which is a 256-bit AES cipher, to secure your desktop. Now, that has a couple of implications. It means that you can't have one sender feeding multiple stations, because when you've done the secure key exchange, and so worst case scenario, you're assuming that Eve is watching your traffic go past. And if she sees your key go past, she takes a little record of it, and then she can decrypt all the encrypted desktop as a result. But if you've done a proper asymmetric key exchange, a public key exchange, and you're now encrypting using an ephemeral key that was exchanged that way, that's impossible. But that means that you can't have one desktop feeding multiple stations. It's an impossibility. And you can't do instantaneous switching between hosts. Now, a lot of our competitors who sell other less secure KVM systems say, oh, well, that's, you know, it's unusable. If I can't switch server instantly, I'm not interested. Or if I can't have multiple workstations seeing the same, multiple desktop positions, multiple operating positions seeing the same server, the same workstation, again, I'm not interested. All that tells us is that they're not doing crypto properly. And we know for a fact that Avasant, for example, do their key exchange in the clear. And so they are encrypted on the wire. You know, it is an encrypted network stream, but they did the key exchange in the clear. So Eve could have just sniffed that key and then decrypt their desktop session. So, you know, talk to NBC Universal, talk to some of the other companies who we've sold Amulet to. And the only reason they could buy that system was because they come under MPAA or FACT or Disney or one of those people. Final thought, crypto is so in the news at the moment. I don't know if you saw John Oliver's piece on HBO last week. It's fantastically funny, but also fantastically salient, mostly to do with the iPhone, but a really important sort of thing to be thinking about. You can find it on YouTube. And there's some recommended reading. you know, as I say there, pretty much all I know about crypto came from XKCD. Here's some really good reading. Simon Singh's codebook is a fantastic intro. Security Engineering by Ross Anderson. You can download it from his website. He's open sourced his own book. You know, true to what he does, he's open sourced his book. Steve Gibson's Security Now podcast. I'd recommend episodes 31 to 37. They are a fantastic crypto primer, just brilliant. Secrets of Station X, again, it's all Bletchley Park and all that kind of stuff. Bruce Schneier, who is a real mover in this space, his book is fantastic, and if you're a real Billy No Mates this weekend and you've got time to kill, all the stuff on my blog about crypto is there as well. So we will stick the recording of this and these notes on our blog later on today, and I invite questions if you're so inclined, or we can go back and get some more coffee if you want. Okay, so I've been reading the same article in Scientific American or other publications since the early 80s, where it says, of course, when they build a quantum computer, you constrain the input qubits with the encrypted message, and because it's a quantum computer, you can instantaneously read out all possible permutations. And what that says to me is you've turned the problem from being one of a temporal problem, one of taking a long time over computing something, to one of searching a big data space. You know, I've been reading the same thing for more than 30 years about how quantum computers are going to blow this all open, and maybe it will, but I can't see how you handle it. If you can search a key space in a second rather than in millions of years, how does that help you?
This is being taken seriously, and people are trying to develop what they're calling quantum resistant cryptography.
Hmm. Yes, so the big thing that people are talking about is not temporal hard problems, but memory hard problems. So if you're using elliptic curve cryptography, you can do something called a memory hard problem, where you rather than relying on taking a long time over computing something, which can always be shrunk by using GPUs and server farms and all that kind of stuff. If you have a memory hard problem where you have to have a complete table in memory, that kind of slows things down. You know, if you have to render a whole table and then do some undetermined walk through the data, that slows things down. But I don't know. I mean, you know, I've trouble enough, you know, kind of repairing, you know, taking surface mount chips off boards and repairing things. You know, I think quantum computing is some way away, even if it's relevant. I don't know.
Okay, thank you. So you don't think it's going to blow the whole thing wide open?
Maybe, but I just don't know. So when you generate your private key, the private key is the two prime numbers, the two very large prime numbers, typically 2,000 bits nowadays. The public key is the product of those two prime numbers, and that's what you put in the certificate store on web browsers. So when you download a new build of Firefox, or when you get a new build of Windows or the Mac OS, which comes with a certificate store as well. You know, Mr. Equifax, Mr. VeriSign, Mr. Google, they've all been allowed to put their public certificates in there.
So it's as simple as adding together two very large prime numbers.
Multiplying together two prime. Yeah. And that is what mathematicians call a non-trivial problem, to factorise a large, and we're talking 4,000 binary digits, factorise that large number back into the two primes that were multiplied together to make it. But there's a very funny story about Enigma. Apparently at the end of the war, the British Army hoovered up as many of them as they could. I mean, obviously the German Army destroyed a lot of them, but they were all brought back to Britain, refurbished, and then distributed to Commonwealth governments with the instruction that, oh, this is fantastic, we never cracked this. And so all the way into the 1970s, Commonwealth governments were sending encrypted traffic, you know, between each, you know, between their embassies and their home offices or whatever, and GCHQ was very merrily decrypting all of it. That's why a lot of the cryptographers who worked at Bletchley Park went straight to GCHQ to decrypt friendly traffic. So this is a fantastic example of not relying on security by obscurity. The Enigma machine, you can understand entirely how it works, and after today, you all understand entirely how this works. But if you don't have the starting state of the machine, i.e. the key, it's just fiendishly difficult to break. Now, the Polish are well known as very competent mathematicians, and they'd figured out this whole thing of an A can never encrypt to an A, etc. And that gives you a bit of purchase into the cipher. Even before the war started, the Polish Secret Service were listening in on German traffic and occasionally decrypting it. It took the massed might of what was going on at Bletchley Park with... So there's that picture I had of Alan Turing.
The Polish intelligence gave them a head start.
Yes, and a lot of those cryptographers came and worked with Turing. So... Oh, if you get the chance, go to Bletchley Park. It is a fantastic day out. And the National Computer Museum's on the same site. You know, it's two fantastic days out. So under the instruction of a guy called Tommy Flowers, who was the chief engineer of the post office at the time, they built these things called the bombs, which, look at this, there's 26 positions going around there. And the bombs were essentially electromechanical computing elements that would check Enigma machine states, and they built thousands of these things. They were kind of acres and acres of racks of these things, sort of chugging away. And so one of the cryptographers would say, "I suspect in the first 12 characters of this message is the word Heil Hitler or weather report or Scheiße or Helga or something like that." You know, they'd keep guessing things, and they'd constrain the output of the bomb to reflect that, and then they'd let the thing just crank away. And eventually, if they get a match, they can read off the key, the state of the machine, from the front of the bombs, and then that's magic. You can crack all of today's traffic because you've now figured out what today's key is. Of course, come midnight, the code book changes, and, 19-year-old conscripts are now using today's code. And twice during the war, they captured code books. And, of course, that gave Bletchley Park, you know, an easy month or an easy couple of weeks before the code book ran out. At the height of the war, 1944, they had more than 8,000 cipher clocks, just trying things, just trying Helga, Renata, and all those other, words at the start of messages to see if they could get a purchase, get a foothold into the cipher for that day. I think the imitation game was not bad compared to that one, is it U-59 from about 10 years ago? Where the Americans capture a submarine and what's this, And there's a code book with it, I mean, that was very misleading, that film. Well, I don't know. I know when we did the Universal Pictures build, it was considered important by the guys at NBC Universal. And in fact, they have a mix of Avacent and Amulet. They use Avacent for things that aren't required to be secure, and they use Amulet for things that are required to be secure. You've got to think to yourself, it's easy to say, isn't it? You watch the network, you see the key go past, then you can decrypt the... it's easy to say, but it must be devilishly difficult to figure out, how to decrypt a remote desktop session. But the MPAA aren't really interested in it's devilishly difficult. They just want to know it's impossible. Increasingly for us, movie companies, MPS in Hammersmith, they're an Amulet user, and I know that was important to them. MPC, your old parish, Tom, I know that's important to them. It seems to be becoming a thing now. I don't know whether it is mandated yet by the MPAA, but you can imagine it will be.